Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for coming. And now I'm going to walk around a little bit, so please don't mind me if I walk around. I am Cameron Crump. I'm with APEB Oakland. It's a social service agency that has been serving the Black community in Oakland and providing for them, teaching them on HIV and AIDS and health disparities in the community, addressing health identity and social justice. And so I am their social media coordinator, their pharmaceutical training liaison, and their community outreach coordinator, and other duties as designed. You know how that goes, right? You just wear all the hats and you just, that's just how it works. So that's who I am, okay? And so I was asked to do this presentation here. And so before I do this presentation, I want to talk about this space first. I know we don't have much time, but I'm going to try to take advantage of whatever time we have to get you all some good food to eat and feed your souls a little bit, all right? But for this space, I just really want to say this is a safe space. Any space that I facilitate, I like to be in control of that space, and I like for everybody's energy to be free and show up holistically however you show up, whoever you are, whatever you like to jump in and comment on, do so. Feel free to express yourself. Now, with this presentation, I want to say this is not the space for any debates. This is not the space for any opinions or any of that. This is to pay homage and for those individuals that are a part of the LGBTQ community that have done a lot of work for the progression for African Americans and for this Black History Month. Does that sound good? Okay, so I wanna get a feel for the room, okay? This is just a general check. I'm gonna show you some pictures and I want people to shout out some names. Is that okay? Can anybody shout out these two names? Okay. Y'all better watch out. Okay, go ahead. Who's this? Well, I mean, his name is up there, but have you ever heard of him? He is the father of Renaissance. He is Alan Leroy Locke. He is a philosopher. Everyone looked to him, okay? During the Renaissance time, everyone looked to him. He was the father of Renaissance. Okay, finish this quote. Where there's no struggle, no progress. Uh-huh. She was like, why are y'all taking so long? Okay, next one. Who's this? Okay, y'all, we in Oakland, y'all better know who this is, okay? He was a part of Peralta College. He went to Merritt. Okay? Okay. Who are these two individuals?
Smith?
Yeah, Bessie Smith. Okay. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Does anyone know who that is? That is Charles Long. He is another philosopher, really good philosopher. He actually studied American religion, and especially when it pertains to African Americans, and he wrote a lot of philosophy books when it comes to American religion. Okay, next.
I'm about to add Martin Luther King Jr.
That's what I'm talking about, okay. Okay, next one. A lot of people don't know that. We're going to talk about him. That's one of my idols from the civil rights movement. Bayard Rustin. That's Bayard Rustin. And that's Jordan right there. She is a poet. She was a poet, and she was also a teacher. June Jordan. Yes, yes, yes. Okay. So the overview for this presentation, we are going to look at the contributions of Black LGBTQIA Black men and women in politics and the arts. And looking at that, we will also examine how these contributions have remained in the shadows and are not so much taught in schools or used as empowerment tools due to structural and cultural factors. Therefore, it is contributing to the crisis in higher education. That's the theme for the month, right? Okay, just making sure I'm online. If I get offline, y'all, don't worry about it. It was doing that earlier. I think, yeah, it is Chrome, though.
It's Chrome?
Yeah. It was Chrome. Maybe it just shut off. I don't know what's happening. And it's gonna update. Okay, do you guys want me to just do this? Okay. Okay, so who could tell me what the acronyms mean in LGBTQIA? Give it to me.
Lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, intersex, and then A can be asexual, ally,
endogenous. Okay, give me the definition of, because some people may not know specifically the, so let's say lesbian, we know that is a woman, right, who is attracted to other women. And then we know gay is a man who is attracted to other men. Bisexual, now a lot of people don't talk about this, but bisexual means you are able to, you're not only physically attracted to the other individual, whether male or female, but you have an emotional, spiritual, and mental connection with the other individual, and you can do so with both sexes, okay? So that's the difference. Transgender is when one's gender identity or expression or behavior is different from those typically associated with their assigned sex at birth. Queer is basically the umbrella of all of it, but I like to switch out queer with questioning and give space for those individuals that are still learning about themselves. I think that is very important. It doesn't matter what age you are, there may come a time where you are still learning about yourself. That's just something that happens, right? Intersex is a person who is born with reproductive or sexual anatomy. Is there anyone next door that can help us with the computer? And asexual is someone who does not experience sexual attraction. So basically, when they are sexually active with someone, they are doing it just for the pleasure of the other person so that they get pleasure, okay? So now, this one. So now, one, I was having a conversation recently and I said, I have to put this into my presentation just in case anyone in here thinks this way. So I was having a discussion with another brother of mine, and the brother said that homosexuality, and I like to switch that out with same gender loving individuals, that whole concept is Eurocentric. What do you all think? Anybody? They said it's Eurocentric. So I had to hit them with this. If homosexuality or same gender loving is Eurocentric, what is heterosexuality? If you have to attribute that to something, you have to attribute heterosexuality to something, right? So with that being said, we're gonna talk about King Mwanga. He was the king of Uganda. And he was one of the first openly queer men. And he was a king. He also had 16 wives. Right? And he also, once we get there, you'll see his picture. This is his picture, y'all, just in case. He had 16 wives, and he also had relationships with men of his court. He was a big advocate for same gender loving individuals. And when the Europeans were coming to bring Christianity, he put up a lot of resistance and fought up against them because they were trying to change everything that was going on. It was the 1880s. And what happened with him, because he put up resistance against the Europeans, then he was moved out and his brother took charge. You can go to the next one. So that's King Mwanga. You can go to the next one. We know who this is, don't we? Moms Mabley. She was a part of the Chitlin' Circuit. Yes, she was. And so the Chitlin Circuit was from the East, the South, and the Upper Midwest. and it was for individuals that were a part of entertainment that would go out and entertain, and it was where they felt safe, right? And they all would go out and entertain together. So this was Loretta Mary Akin. She is known as Jackie Moms Mabley. And she was a comedian and a part of the Chitlin Circuit. And she was billed as the funniest woman in the world. And she would actually mix her comedy with satirical music. She also came out with albums that included music and comedy. And she talked about race and inequality. We know who this is. Yes, this is Zora Neale Hurston, the folk, I like to call her the folklorist. I mean, everybody does, right? I read so many books of hers. And she is really known for Their Eyes Were Watching God. Everybody's read this book, whether in middle school or high school or college. And so she was also an anthropologist that a lot of people don't know. She was a lesbian anthropologist, and she did a lot of work with Langston Hughes. She did a lot of work with Bayard Rustin, and she was among those Harlem Renaissance individuals. She was an anthropologist that studied in the Caribbean and in the South, and she would go around learning religious culture. So that's why when you read a lot of her books, they include a lot of voodoo. She's talking about priestess. She's talking about different people in villages. And she brings a lot of that to light. And she was very interested in culture, the deep depth of religious culture. Pass me on. Frantz Fanon. He was also a Caribbean. He was a philosopher. He was a revolutionary and a writer. He was inspired by national liberation movements, and he was a part of radical political organizations and wrote numerous of books, especially The Wretched of the Earth. And that's what he was really big on. And he always talked about colonization and decolonization.
So Frantz Fanon was a transgender?
Yes. Yes, he was. In this section, we're talking about same gender loving. At first, I just wanted to see what y'all know. Who y'all know in your black history? I see Alameda College is doing pretty good, talking about it a little bit, right? Yeah? Y'all sound unsure. We have a good black history program here? African American studies program here?
Okay.
Y'all let me know. Next one. Lorraine Hansberry. Who knows who Lorraine Hansberry is without reading it?
Oh, yeah.
Go ahead.
Oh,
okay, yeah. Well, when you think about it, Raisin in the Sun, all of that, she was a playwright, and she was friends with Langston Hughes, and she worked with W.E.B. Du Bois, Paul Robeson, all of them worked together. I think that's what I love the most, is when you look at the history and you look at these individuals, they all had their own narrative, but collectively, they worked together, and that's what's beautiful. She also was the inspiration for Nina Simone's To Be Young, Gifted, and Black, because Nina Simone liked her. Lorraine Hansberry was big about free spirit and free sexuality, and she was a lesbian. No better place to go than to Nina Simone, right? Singer, who could tell me about Nina Simone? Nobody. I'm coming back up here a few times. I will be back. Okay, she was a singer, songwriter. Y'all could have even said something from her biopic or something, from her movie. And she was a pianist. She wrote songs that addressed race, that addressed all the things that were going on during the time. And Mississippi Goddamn was one of her biggest ones, one of her biggest hits. And what I'll do is I'll send out these slides to everyone. If you would like it, I'll send out the slides to you if you make sure you sign in. Go ahead. Langston Hughes. Who can tell me about Langston Hughes? Someone's going to tell me about one of these individuals that are up here. Langston Hughes. Now, I look young, but see, I'm 30. And I come from listen, I know that seems like a lot. I may be a baby, but people look at me and think I'm like 19. But I come from a matchbox church to where when people said things, Bishop Lewin, my grandfather, would just go ahead and point you out and just, you didn't have a choice, okay? Now, I don't want to have to channel Bishop Lewin a little bit. Okay, now I know somebody in here knows Langston Hughes. He was the inspiration for A Raisin in the Sun. Can you give me one of the quotes that was in A Raisin in the Sun that came from one of his poems? Yes. Boom. That's my, you the one. Make sure I get your information. I'm gonna bring you one. I'm gonna bring you something. I'm coming back to bring you something. Come on, Audre Lorde. I like to just say Lorde for some reason.
Oh, see the writer.
Yes. Tell me more.
See why you don't keep yourself lesbian or keep yourself simple white to keep it warm.
Yes. And she was known for mastery. I love this part. She was known for technical mastery and emotional expression. She addressed issues related to civil rights, feminism, and the exploitation of black female identity. We know who this is.
Angela Davis.
Yes. And did you all know that she was a professor at UC Santa Cruz, right?
As a waiting list, mile long.
Yes. Yeah, listen, I was one of those individuals. I was like, she's there? I need to sign up to, yes, Angela Davis. She was also a big part of the Black Panther Party. She collaborated with them. She's big on social consciousness, philosophy, and also history. And that's what she taught there at UC Santa Cruz. Barbara Jordan. She was a lawyer, an educator. She was also a senator. She was really known for her opening statements. And she was the first African-American woman to deliver the keynote address at a Democratic National Convention. She received the Presidential Medal of Freedom, and she was the first African-American woman to be buried at Texas State Cemetery. Ellis Hazlett. So do you all know his show, Soul, on PBS? He is a big producer of that show. He is one of the individuals in art that did a lot of producing behind the scenes and on set, and he was a big part of getting a lot of singers and performers onto the stage and onto television. We know who this is?
Octavia Butler.
Octavia Butler. What about Octavia Butler? Has anyone read her books?
Yes.
What can you tell me about her books? Right. It's science. She has a strong passion for science fiction, and all of her.
She writes it really well.
Yes.
I don't like science fiction, but I like her.
She is amazing. When I tell you someone that will keep you on the edge of your seat and into the book, a lot of people that do not like science fiction will read Octavia Butler's books. She has a way of carrying throughout her stories a theme of race and sexuality. And also sowing of seeds, energy, and all of that is incorporated into her storytelling. My favorite, Bayard Rustin. Who could tell me something about him? Anything. Well, what you will know is that you probably should know Bayard Rustin more than you know Martin Luther King. Bayard Rustin organized both of the marches. He worked closely with Philip Randolph. He also worked with James Baldwin. He also worked with Stokely Carmichael. He worked with all of the organizations with getting everyone together. He was the one to organize the bus, the sit-ins. He was the mastermind behind all of that. He was so humble about it and would just keep letting people take the light. And he was so open about being a part of two minority groups. And him and Martin had a conversation, and even Martin said, do you think that I should be in the front instead of you? And he pushed Martin to the front because he realized that what's more important is what you see, and that's the color of the skin. And right now, dealing with Martin being a pastor, it probably wasn't the best time to deal with sexuality with everything else that was going on. So he was a major part of integration in the civil rights movement and all of that. Get to know him. Very important. Alice Walker, we know her. We know, look, everybody's smiling. Everybody like, oh my goodness. You didn't know that she was a lesbian? She sure is. Alice Walker is a lesbian, and she is an advocate, and she wrote The Color Purple, and it's thematic throughout her stories. Go ahead. Come on. We all know. We all know. Gospel music is the gay man's blues. Let's not play these games. Let's not play these games. Let's not play these games. Don't play with me. Gospel music is the gay man's blues. Come on, think about it. Am I wrong?
No.
Let's think about it. But this, let me tell you something. This man was so special. When I tell you I don't feel no ways tired, okay, where is your faith? These were significant songs to our culture that helped get us through. And we're still playing them today. We're still singing them today. So he is known as the king of gospel music. Okay? The king of gospel music. Okay. Bless you, James. Okay. So now let's talk about a few people here. We already talked about Elaine, Leroy Locke, but we didn't talk about Sylvester. Who knows Sylvester? Sylvester was a singer. He was like, he really helped pave the way for individuals that were trying to be themselves, right? That had that struggle. He was very androgynous. He was very free-spirited. And when I tell you can sing, he can sing. Okay? Also, I'm trying to find my notes here. There's specific ones that I want to. Right here, we have a trans activist, a trans man activist. Okay? He is also a lawyer, and he also started a trans coalition, Kyler Brodus. Sherman Hemsley? Come on. Y'all know. Stop it. Y'all know Sherman Hemsley. Okay, and you know Marsha P. Johnson, another one, she was a part of Stonewall, big time activist, as well as Essex Hemphill. He is also another activist and a poet and a writer. And he is also one of the individuals that started creating spaces for conversation that needed to happen and that were very taboo within the Black community. Here we have Dr., I can never say, say her name correctly. She is the first Black lesbian woman, Black woman, to be ordained in the Episcopal Church. Pauli Murray. Pauli Murray. Dr. Pauli Murray. She is the first black woman to be ordained. Yes. Right here we have Imam Abdullah, and he is a part of the Muslim religion, and he is the first openly out gay male, and he is a leader, a big time leader in the faith. And he works with bridging the gap between different interfaiths as well as Muslim faiths. Now, we can't talk about art and not talk about the house and ballroom community, okay? This is big. Has anybody heard about the house and ballroom community? Well, let me tell you. Most of everything that you like that interests you on reality TV or in fashion and in dancing, it comes from right here. The house and ballroom community, okay? Go ahead. This is a subculture, okay? It began over 50 years ago. It is international now, okay? It started in Harlem. And so what would happen is people would go and they would get their fancy clothes. What you have not worn, that outfit that you've been trying to find a place to wear, find a place to wear it to, this is where you want to wear it, okay? You pull it out the back of the closet and you wear it here. This is a place to be celebrated and not tolerated. So individuals, first of all, when we call it house and ballroom, the reason why we call it house and ballroom is because individuals would be ostracized from their own homes. Mm-hmm. And then they would go to these individuals that are not their biological parents, and they created a house, a family, okay? So if Charles Washington was a father of a house, then they would be the Washingtons, okay? So they created these spaces where people can move from their abusive homes where they were ostracized, and they can be with these families that would help empower them, that would help groom them, and help give them the empowerment that they need to live instead of run away or commit suicide or fall into a slippery slope that was not best for them, okay? So that's where House and Ballroom came in. And then what they would do, they would have these big balls with different categories where they would walk like it's a fashion show, and they would wear their best outfits with music, and they would compete. And they would have competition on face, who can walk runway, who could do the best costume, and all of that, right? And that's where voguing comes in. And so balls happen very, very late. I can't go anymore. It's too late. They'll tell you it starts at 10, but they won't start till 1:30. But let me tell you the history behind it, and that's what I did at first. I said, why nobody here? Why are we going to eat? We're about to start. The reason why it starts so late is because they needed places to have these balls. And so the history behind it is what they would do is go and wait till everybody goes home from their job at the warehouse, and they would sneak into the warehouse and hold the balls until like 6, 6:30 in the morning. And so usually even nowadays they held onto that tradition, and nowadays when you come out of a ball, the sun is up. The sun is up. These individuals, can you all tell me who these individuals are? These are present day individuals that are making history right now. Some of them in your city.
Oh, I know, but one in America, I just can't remember her name.
Okay. We have Bishop Yvette Flunder. We have Robin Roberts from GMA. Yes. Dropping Jaw. She's out. Yes, she is. Janet Mock. Big time trans activists. We have Laverne Cox, right? And also Janet Mock did more than that. She also worked with Time Magazine. She worked with People Magazine, all of that. And we have Frenchie Davis. We have Laverne Cox. Everybody knows her from Orange is the New Black, yes. And she's also gonna be on another series coming up. Also, Don Lemon. I love Don Lemon's story because Don Lemon said, you know, he was writing his book. And when he was writing his book and he was talking about his sexuality, he had the publisher take it out. And when he had him take it out, a young man committed suicide. And he realized, you know what? My story could save somebody's life. And he put it back in there. And of course, Frank Ocean. Oh, DeRay McKesson. Big time activist. He's a part of Black Lives Matter. He was there in Ferguson. He was traveling with all of the killings. And he also decided to run, I want to say Senator. Yeah. But it wasn't at his home state. So that was like a lot of people were like, why don't you, run for your home state? Okay. Everybody know who this is, right? Andre Talley. Big time editor at large for Vogue, okay? Everybody knows Lee Daniels. Everybody knows Wanda Sykes, Keith Boykin, RuPaul, and Kenyatta. He's another advocate. And Keith Boykin is he's a BET correspondent. Education, when you see this word education, what comes to mind? Learning? Y'all got to give me something.
Empowerment.
What'd you say? Did you go through my iPad? Click the next slide. She just starting too much trouble. When you see this word, what does this mean? What comes to mind? Empowerment. What do you think about the moment you were empowered? Now I need you guys I'm gonna start making you all respond, because this is very important. You felt what?
Oh, I didn't say that.
Oh. Who said strength? Strength, okay, you said strength. What else?
Freedom.
Confidence. Go ahead to the next one. To educate is to empower. So if I could give you a little bit of my narrative. I grew up in a white suburb. While growing up in a white suburb, I was raised by my father, minister, mother, evangelist, grandfather, bishop. And they all lived in the same house. We all lived in the same house. So, and we are from Kingston and Frankfield, Jamaica. Yes. And so, I get it. Nobody's ever lived this before. They don't know how to handle it. But I had to deal with the duality of being Black and gay, right? So my body was, and my spirit was saturated with a lot of things. I felt like, you know, I don't have a future. I used to look out the window and be like, I don't even know what I want to be, right? And it was because I was not being educated at all about people who came before me that were just like me. And so I was only being taught whatever was being taught in school. At the same time, it is so important to educate individuals on others that came before them. Like for me, my purpose, I say all the time, is to be the individual I needed when I was younger. And that's what gives me my drive, right? And so with that, I want to make sure I'm relatable. I didn't have anybody to look to. I didn't know about Bayard Rustin. I had to do my own reading to say, wow, this guy, I want to be like him. I want to go around and talk on health, identity, and justice. So to educate individuals is to empower them. Talk about individuals that are relatable to what they are and who they are, right? So if an individual is Black and gay, hey, let me tell you about someone that came before you. You may feel like you're not empowered or that you're no one, but let me tell you about the individual that wrote The Color Purple, a book and a movie that is so big in our Black culture and has so many messages. What does that do to someone? What if someone came to you, whatever you wanted to be or want to be right now, and said, this person in your city did this, what would you do? Would you go out and look for them? Would you be empowered to do more and find out what did they do to get where they are, right? So when I think about empowerment, these are the words that come to me. I think about enriched, being enriched, motivated, being pushed, overcoming barriers and obstacles, winning, evaluating self and empowering others, and having a resilient attitude, being resilient, right? To educate is to empower, but we don't hear about these things in our school systems. These are things that are not talked about, because even you dropped your mouth, you're still shy. You're like, what? I did not, and these are people that have talked about it, right? So it's okay for us to talk about it. It's not like it's a secret. They talk about it themselves, and they're bold about it. But at the same time, somewhere down the line, we get quiet, and we don't pass it on, and we don't use it as an empowerment tool. And that's what we need in our higher education. Relatability. What do these two pictures mean to you when you see this? Look at it for just 30 seconds, and tell me what you get. Think about what we talked about, education and empowerment. What do you get from it?
Just the importance of being able to see yourself reflected in the world around you and media and in everything else.
I was going to say developing a positive identity. On his way to develop.
Yeah, yeah. Anybody else?
I would say on the left is what you can be, and on the right is where you are and who you become.
I like that. Anyone else? Let's go to the next slide. The thing is, we're not talking about it because there are structural and cultural factors that are acting as barriers against us. So when we think structural, we think economic, social, policy, and organizational, right? So policy, social, economic, example, Trump. Trump would be a barrier. Something like that, right? Trump would be a barrier. Something in policy. What else could be a structural barrier? Can anybody give me an example? Religion, okay. And religion could be a cultural factor, right? Right, because of values, customs, and structural, because religion has a structure to it. There's a way how you go about things, right? And that can be a barrier. What else is there? Education. Yeah. Curriculum. Mm-hmm. Right? There's a process to getting the curriculum out. Yes.
I was just going to say in language. So when we talk about policy, if you're filling out forms and there's only male and female as gender options and things like that, those are policies and structures that are in place to not recognize other options or categories.
Exactly. And another thing that you brought up, now that's a good side of language, and to flip it on the other side, stigmatizing language, right? We don't realize what we're saying when someone is in the room. We just think it's okay, because it's natural. It's just like the whole thing that went around, that's gay, or no homo. We don't know who's around. I tell my father this story all the time, and he brings it up. He says, yes, you tell me all the time. So my grandfather, he had a caretaker in the home. And the caretaker, it was during summertime, so I was there at home every day with her, and we would hang out, we would like watch TV and stuff, we'd laugh, have a little key, it's a little lingo for y'all. Have a little key, and she knew like sexuality was a thing with me, right? So it was like a struggle then. So she was having this conversation with my father in the kitchen. And I was standing on the other wall, on the opposite side of the wall, and she asked him, what would you do now? I'm the youngest of three boys, and I love my father. I admire him a lot. And she asked him, what would you do if one of your sons were gay? And his response was, I don't know what I'd do. I'd kill myself or try to kill them. Now, in that moment, all I could think about was, if Dad thinks this about me, then God must think this about me, because that's who introduced me to God. And that's how I know him. So ever since then, it just was, so that's another barrier. Because back then, I didn't have my own personal relationship like I do now. I mean, now I'm getting my Master's of Divinity, studying sexuality and religion. I'm a seminarian. Like, who would think I would be doing that now and be comfortable trying to bridge a gap between faith and justice? And I understand it. That's something that I had to go through to get here. And I had to do a lot of educating for myself. But that's a barrier. We don't realize what we say. And to this day, my dad will be like, yes, I remember I said that. I won't forget. I said, I'm going to make sure you don't forget, too. You know, but those things made our relationship stronger now. But how can we educate others about these structural factors and cultural factors? Now that we have named what they are, what strategies can we do to address them? What do you think we can do to help adjust language? Take advantage of teachable moments. A lot of times, it's sad to say, but a lot of times it's when people have their own child, right? And then they have to learn that way, right? My mom says all the time, that's how I'm learning. That's how she learns. But a lot of times we say things like, a lot of black women have gay friends. But a lot of black women will say, I don't want my child to be gay. Of course, naturally, that's something that we don't want. We don't want them to have to go through all those things that, like, I had to go through or experience those things. But what can we do to make that experience different? If you have a friend like that, then you have someone that can harbor with them, that can be there and help get you through if that's the case. So what strategies can we use to address these structural factors and cultural factors so we can start talking about these individuals that came before us and have done so much work to get us where we are? What would you say?
Well, one is we have to stop being in denial that it's not in front of us. We still want to say it's not there.
Yeah. Yeah.
And once a person acknowledges something, then you have to, one way or the other, you're going to have to.
Addressing denial. I like that. Anybody else? Anybody else? I'm telling you, I'm coming back. I'm coming back, and I am about to, we're going to have testimony service. I'm going to start calling on people's names. Go ahead to the next slide. Any questions? Any questions? Yeah, we're going to have to wear some tags or something. We're going to get it together. Are there any questions? No? I really appreciate you all coming and being a part of this presentation. I hope you ate something and you learned something and that you have some takeaways. And I would like to take, I would like to take away something as well, and that would be these evaluations. So if you all could please do an evaluation, I would really appreciate it. Thank you so much for coming.
Very special, almost a kickoff for the year. I think it's really important that we celebrate, that we celebrate the legacy of our people, that we celebrate the contributions of our people. And that celebration should be spirit-filled in a way that allows us to do things for the future. There's such a negative perception sometimes about people of African ancestry. And so I wanted to really use this month to talk about our goodness. How many folks went out and seen the film Hidden Figures? All right, clap it up, clap it up. That film was very brilliant. Very brilliant. But I also want to say that we're not hidden. There's nothing hidden about our genius. Right? We're actually standing right here in the midst of everyone. And one of my close friends did a TED Talk, and his TED Talk was called The Myth of the Extraordinary Negro. And the reality is that a lot of times, in order for this society to see us, we have to be extraordinary. We have to be beyond what people expect of us. But we're greatness in just our existence. And I think it's important that we always remember that. So this month is celebrating the souls of Black folk. So I definitely wanted to acknowledge W.E.B. Du Bois, not just for his scholarship, but for his understanding of our greatness and how we tried to usher that forward through Pan-Africanism and his efforts with the NAACP. And so in this day and throughout the month, and hopefully throughout the year, that we'll celebrate on this campus. And so for all the students that are here, I want you to take this energy and take it into the classroom and take it into your personal life and make change through it. And for all the instructors here, what I want you to do, I want you to make sure you create a space that's student-centered so students can get what they need from you in your class. Sometimes we focus on curriculum, but sometimes we have to focus on the students and what the students' needs are. Sometimes it's greater than just the curriculum. So let's use this time as a catalyst and let's celebrate. Thank you for being here.
Every community has important traditions, and one of the traditions in the African descent community of people who are African-American, Afro-American, Negro-American, we speak some folks with Afro-Saxons. Whoever we are, we always had traditions. And those traditions are important to remind us of who we are. This tradition, this libation, is done in many ways around the world. We use a little bit of water and pour it onto the earth to represent the connection between heaven and earth. We give thanks in whatever language, in whatever ways we give thanks to the creator of all the universe, and we say Ashe.
Ashe.
We give thanks for our mothers and fathers for birthing us so we could be here today, because by show of hands, did anybody here birth themselves? You birth yourself? All right, you popped out, you cut the cord, jumped up off the table. We all gotta be thankful for somebody. So in this tradition, this libation, we want to do at least three things on this first day of celebrating the history of one part of our community, celebrating the history of the African-American community, of the Africans. It's three things I want you to remember about libations. The first thing is, in fact, to remember. Everybody say remember.
Remember.
Remember the accomplishments of those who came before us. Those of you who are students, you need to know that whatever field of endeavor you're interested in, there's somebody who has laid the path for that. There was a pioneer. Because if you're in cosmetology, if you're taking, you know, if you're in beauty and fashion, Madam C.J. Walker is your role model. Say Ashe.
Ashe.
If you are interested in botany, George Washington Carver was a great scientist who did work in that field, and say Ashe.
Ashe.
If you're interested in community organizing, Cesar Chavez is a great role model because he was down in those fields, down in the valley, organizing people for better lives, and we say Ashe.
Ashe.
If you are concerned about the health of people, then Yuri Kochiyama is your role model because she lived right here in Oakland, but when she was a young person, she lived in Harlem. She was friends with Malcolm X. She worked as an advocate for people's well-being for a long time. If you are interested in women's rights in the political system, Susan B. Anthony should be your hero. She helped women get the vote. We say Ashe.
Ashe.
And today, in particular for Black History Month, we want to remember all those ancestors, all those people who came before us, and we just say Ashe.
Ashe.
But we also want to reflect. Say reflect.
Reflect.
Not only remember, because remembering is one thing, that you conjure up those memories, but to reflect on them, to understand their importance, to remember why the ancestors' work was so important, to reflect on what you could do differently is important. So we reflect on all of our history today and we say Ashe.
Ashe.
And lastly, we want to renew ourselves. Because that renewal, especially in this time, especially when we have people who are in power who don't care about us, people in power who are misogynists, people in power who are racist. Don't get quiet on me. Y'all know what I'm talking about. I'm trying to do my best never to call that name in public, because I ain't trying to give them that kind of look. But y'all know what I'm talking about. And it's renewing. It ought to give us energy to get better organized, better educated, better fed, to do the work we need to do.
I want to give thanks to all my elders in the room. I am an instructor here, I'm a department chair here, but I'm also a part of a community organization, the Brotherhood of Elders Network. Can I have those elders stand up for me, please? The Brotherhood of Elders Network. The Brotherhood of Elders Network is an intergenerational organization of Black men that are concerned about the welfare of Black boys. Black men and are committed to doing work to create change in their lives and the environment around them. And so when I figured out that I wanted to put this event on, they were at the forefront of providing funds to make sure this happens. So I give thanks to them. I give thanks to them for being models to me. I appreciate you all. And in that spirit, we want to make sure we always honor our young people. And so we're going to have our young people, YGB, come up and do something special for you all. Give it up for YGB.
We are asking everyone to stand and repeat after us. The African
African pledge.
The African pledge.
We are an African people.
We are an African people.
We will remember.
We'll remember.
The humanity.
The humanity.
Glory.
Glory.
And suffering.
And suffering.
Of our ancestors.
Of our ancestors.
We will honor.
We will honor.
The struggle.
The struggle.
Of our elders.
Of our elders.
We will strive.
We will strive.
To bring new values.
To bring new values.
And new life.
And new life.
To our people.
To our people.
We will have peace.
We'll have peace.
And harmony.
And harmony.
Among us.
Among us.
We will be loving.
We will be loving.
Sharing.
Sharing.
And creating.
And creating.
We will work.
We will work.
Study.
Study.
And listen.
And listen.
So we may learn.
So we may learn.
Learn so we may teach.
Learn so we may teach.
We will cultivate.
We will cultivate.
Self-reliance.
Self-reliance.
We will struggle.
We will struggle.
To resurrect.
To resurrect.
And unify.
And unify.
Our homeland.
Our homeland.
We will raise.
We will raise.
Many children.
Many children.
For our nation.
For our nation.
We will have discipline.
We will have discipline.
Patience.
Patience.
Devotion.
Devotion.
And courage.
And courage.
We will live as models.
We will live as models.
Provide new directions for our people.
For our people.
We will be free.
We'll be free.
And self-determined.
And self-determined.
We are an African people.
We are an African people, and we will win.
For black boys, you wade through your people's gun smoke from a battle nobody ever named more than a struggle. White folks are afraid when you speak, hot wound where your mouth should be, and where you see God. They see 10 man-made from prison bars, gorillas trained to shoot. You're a heavenless thing to them. Wings made of pork bone, a halo grown, tied in fat tights around your neck. How do you describe a sunset? Of course, the casket from birth. The Grim Reaper is named Ray Ray. He is your cousin, has tears inked into his cheek because no one ever told him he was beautiful enough to cry. And now he has a talent for making ghosts.
Don't. memorized, recited, and performed.
These are lessons
meant to be taught in real time. The making of heroes requires repetition. The making of sheroes requires consistency, requires reciprocity.
Culture.
To save ourselves, we must save them, you must save us, and we must save you.
Requires awareness.
Acceptance. Actual application of what we know is right. Out of the mouths of babies.
You gotta do better. We must expect better for you. For ourselves, we cannot become the wretched of the earth, the forgotten victims of our own undereducation. Willing slaves feeding a system bent on annihilation. These songs are written for us.
So we survive another generation. We cannot afford to not know the words.
Thank you.